This spot in particular. Well, underneath all that concrete there, the stairway, there are two pipelines that run out into the ocean, and one is an old sewer pipeline, and that is a pipeline that the city is proposing to use to draw water in to the desalination plant from the ocean. The other pipeline that goes out is the current wastewater flow out farther out into the ocean, and that's where the brine from the desalination plant is planned to go. So the plan is to take the waste from the desalination plant, which is proposed for over on Delaware Avenue, mix it with the wastewater right here, and then on out to the ocean. So the intake of the water of the ocean water, when the plant is running at full capacity, will be about 7 million gallons a day. That's 7 million gallons of ocean water that will pass through some filters so that the large fish will not be captured. So a 2-millimeter mesh screen will filter out anything larger than that. But everything smaller than that will be drawn into the plant, and that means all the fish larvae, every fish larva is smaller than 2 millimeters. All the plankton that is the basis for the food chain. And I want to remind you of all the humpback whales that people went to see a few months ago that were out frolicking right off the coast here, and people went out to look at that. Well, they feed on all that plankton. So 7 million gallons a day would run into the plant, and everything would be killed on the membranes of the plant. So that's why we're here at this particular spot. I don't happen to think that any of this is going to come to pass, and the reason is that the voice of the citizens is beginning to be heard. So first off, I'd like to introduce Celia Scott.
It has been a long time, some 40 years or so, but I'm glad that I'm still here and that we're all still here, and I'd like to thank you all for coming out today. I'd like to think about something, a few things, the initiative process. Well, think of the whole California coastline, 1,200 miles of it. Back in 1972, because we have the right to the initiative in the state constitution, we created the Coastal Act, and we've been able to preserve and protect our coastline. And it was the people of this state that did that after the legislature failed to act. So, and locally, we have done a number of things through the initiative process. I'd like to mention one of them, and that is the creation of the Santa Cruz Greenbelt in 1979. That was also done by the people of this community, and we created a permanent green belt around our community, something that we all treasure. And so the Constitution, think about it. What we're here today to support is the right to vote being included in the charter of the city of Santa Cruz, and that's our constitution, our local constitution. And once we put it in the constitution, it can only be changed by a vote of the people again. It can't be changed by 4 votes on the city council. It's there. And so it's a guaranteed right to vote, and that's why we got these t-shirts on, guarantee the right to vote.
Yeah.
And so that's why I'm here today, and I think that's why many of you are here today. And I think that's a good reason to be here in this gorgeous place. Thank you very much.
I think Celia's suggested what is actually going on here, and that's that there is a process
of Santa Cruz taking control of how this community develops. Yeah. And that process, this is another step in that process. People were very proud to be part of the process in 72 and 79, and people should be very proud to be part of this process right now, because we're moving through our history and trying to preserve our particular environment in a very special way. When I was involved in the process of looking at DSAL, I was ready to listen. I still am ready to listen. If somebody can tell me that we're not getting involved in a $100 million boondoggle, if we're not getting involved in something that our community really can't afford and that our environment really can't afford, I'm ready to listen if somebody can tell me that this is something that would work to our benefit. If it goes through a process of election, if it goes through a process of developing arguments, I think we're going to understand a whole lot better what we're getting ourselves into. And so people should support this process. I don't understand people who don't support this process, to tell you the truth. People should support this process and try to figure out ways for us to develop an answer that makes sense for our communities.
Well, I have three simple things I want to say today. I actually wrote them down just to be electronically enhanced. If you look around this region and you appreciate the natural environment you see, or the livable human scale neighborhoods that you see around here, then you have to appreciate why we need the right to vote on a desal plant. Because the reason that we have the preserved beautiful environment and the beautiful, wonderful, livable neighborhoods is because the people of Santa Cruz have spoken up and have demanded and have exercised democracy. And they've done that as part of something that's now shown up worldwide, which is that wherever in the world there is more democracy, the environment is better off and the communities are more livable. This is demonstrated, and we have been part of exercising that and demonstrating it. My second concern is economic. The desal plant as proposed will be hugely expensive, particularly for a community of our small size. Even more of concern to me is that the operating costs of a desal plant will be forever tied to the costs of energy. And energy, we know, is going to continue to get more and more expensive. And what does that mean? That means every home and every business and every school in the water district is going to have its monthly operating cost forever rising. This is not a fair thing to do to the people of Santa Cruz without their voice in the decision. So that's the second reason. Finally, I am distressed by the tone of the discussion about desal today in Santa Cruz. And this brings me to the third reason why we need to guarantee the right to vote. And that is that some city leaders seem to have already made up their minds that a desal plant is the only solution. They should not be making up their minds before the people.
So in order to put our conviction into practice, we're going to pass around a bucket. And please, with your donation, you can get one of these beautiful T-shirts. And I want to introduce Russ Berchet over the table there, who's the artist who painted the painting that went onto the T-shirt. Thank you, Russ.
You know, Peter Douglas, you know, he died this past week. He was the executive director of the Coastal Commission. He fought, he helped write the Coastal Act, 1976. I'm always reminding students up at UC, I'm trying to talk it up about the Coastal Act. And Peter said, the coast is never saved. The coast is always being saved. When I was at City Hall, people would throw up their hands and go, oh, we lost another development. We'll never have another developer or another person want to do a project in Santa Cruz. And so they'd go out that door, and through the next door would be the next person who just discovered Santa Cruz wanting to propose something. Well, the thought I want to leave all of you, and I know that a lot of you have been at this for a long time, is Santa Cruz is never saved. Santa Cruz is always being saved by you and you and you and you.
Citizen participation is the core of our democracy. And we have not only the right to vote, but we also have the right to know. There is so much we don't know that needs to be taken a look at. So it's my perception, outside the corridors of City Hall, away from the PowerPoint presentations and the city's process of data framing, that there's a lot of confusion in the community. I think the letter to the editor that was in the paper recently said it very well. that we can appear before the hearings at LAFCO at the university and talk about, we've got water. We want you to develop. We will provide. And then on the other hand, be talking about, it will be dire consequences if we don't move on this right away. Well, the staff will say that that is also due to the fact that we must plan ahead for those dire drought years. Okay, but does that sound a little bit to you like cutting butter with a chainsaw? I mean, we are talking about over $100 million. $12 million has been spent already. So it's clear to me that the city powers that be have the bias towards the project. And I think there are many of us that feel that the examination and exploration and discussion concerning viable opportunities for alternatives has been inadequate. Okay. So we have the right to know those costs, the benefits, and the potential of any of those alternatives. We owe it to the ratepayers and the future generations. It is bigger than just our community. We have to have those discussions broader in the whole region and foster a discussion about what are our needs? What about the agricultural areas that we want to maintain? What about a sustainable level of development? What does that look like? We must engage in that discussion. We are at a crossroads. Right now, we must demand our right to know and our right to vote. Thank you very much.